Hi. Hello. So, I would like to draw your attention to the provisions of GST with reference to input tax credit. I take a few valuable minutes of you, and I would like you to think of it and give your opinion also. If you like my point of view, you can simply like, you can press a like button, or if you are new, first time means you can also subscribe. First of all, please watch this video and listen to what I say for a few minutes intently, then you come to draw your inferences. See, first of all, what I would like to draw your attention is, see, this is GST. There are certain provisions of GST which are very harsh on traders and manufacturers. Why and how? Simply, it says, the provision says that input tax credit, you know, taxes paid at input level on input purchases or input supply, inward supplies of goods or services or even capital goods, you are eligible to take input tax credit, which you can use as set off against the output level taxes, outward supplies. So that is input tax credit, because it makes it, it seeks to remove cascading effect. There would be no tax on tax, because it's a value added taxation system. So government is liberal to see that there is no cascading, or at least cascading effect is reduced. The objective is laudable, very good. And see, on one hand it says, A and B, if you look at these two clauses, subclauses A and B, it says a registered person is eligible to take input tax credit only when he receives invoice. He is in possession of invoice. Invoice or bill or debit note, whatever it is. So eligible document is in his hands. Number one. And number two, he has received goods or services. You are a manufacturer, you have purchased some inputs or capital goods, and the goods must be in your premises, you must receive. Otherwise, you are not eligible. So these two conditions must be satisfied simultaneously, both. The question is, one simple point is, received, what do you mean by receiving the services? Goods is okay, physical, because they are tangible property. Physically the goods came to your factory or premises, whatever it is. So you are taking credit, or your shop or go down, whatever it is, you are taking credit, because goods are tangible property. What about services? What do you mean by receiving of services? Is it using of services, utilizing of services, or simply? So receiving of services makes no sense. It requires explanation, but simply it leaves receiving services. There would be a lot of confusion. There would be a lot of litigation also. What do you mean by receiving of services? How do you determine receiving? That's a big area. So okay. So next, if you look at the point of levy, liability. Elsewhere, say, look at section 12 and other provisions, if you say, liability to pay GST, that is tax arises on the goods I am talking. I am not talking about services, because for services earlier also it was there, and today also it is there. For goods, liability arises to receive any advance payment or delivered or removed goods from your premises. Because with the removal of goods, automatically there should be accompanying invoice, bill. Without document, you can't remove goods. You can't release goods from your factory or shop or godown, whatever it is. So when you receive advance or remove goods, whichever is earlier, So whichever is earlier, I am not considering other parameters. So by this, what is the implication? Suppose you are a trader, received advance, payment received, your tax liability arose. You did not deliver the goods, you did not supply, and maybe it is likely to be cancelled also, the order may be cancelled. Today you have received advance, tomorrow that may be cancelled, after some time it may be cancelled, and you have to go for, you have to apply for refund. Complicated, because advance receipt for a trader means it is only an agreement to sell, agreement to supply. There is not a concluded supply or sale, whatever it is, but still your liability confirmed and you have to pay. And similarly, you are a manufacturer. This is more dangerous. So you are a manufacturer, and you are a manufacturer of heavy machinery equipment, manufacturer of capital goods. You manufacture machines and equipments for others. Suppose somebody is starting a textile industry and he places an order with you, because you manufacture plant and machinery for textile industry, capital goods manufacturer. So obviously, say it will be, order will be running in crores. Say there is a 100 crore order. You have received an order for goods, capital goods worth, machine equipment worth 100 crore, and obviously in a heavy capital goods or capital goods industry, without advance order will not be accepted. So obviously advance will be there, say sometimes even 50%, sometimes 100%, depending upon the standard and position of the manufacturer. So here, say for example 50 crore this manufacturer has received on order, so he has accepted the order, he would be supplying after 6 months or 1 year as the case may be. It may take time, lead time will be very long sometimes. Sometimes it may take 2 years or 3 years, so from the date of receiving order. So the moment the manufacturer has received the order with advance amount for 50 crore rupees, his liability arises, he has to pay GST. Okay? So Mr. X or X Limited is a customer who paid 50 crore rupees, is not eligible to take input tax credit, whereas this gentleman is liable to pay GST. His liability arises, he has to pay and wait, sit pretty for 6 months or 1 year, because it takes time. And for 6 months or 1 year, the person who paid 50 crore rupees, not a single amount, it happens practically, who paid 50 crore rupees to this gentleman is not able to avail any input tax credit, because the law says you are eligible to take credit only when you have received in your hands and also received goods. Both the conditions should be simultaneously satisfied. So in this case, not satisfied, so he is not eligible to take input tax credit, but he is liable to pay GST. But what was the existing scheme? What is the existing scheme under central excise or sales tax? If you see, in the case of sales tax, if a trader receives in advance, he need not pay any tax, because it was not fructified, deal was not fructified. When there is a sale, virtually only then only he was liable to pay sales tax. Now he is liable to pay GST even on advance received. Done. What about the manufacturer? Manufacturer was liable to pay excise duty only when he is removing goods from his premises, from his factory. Till removal he need not. Even it is a case if he clears the goods from his factory to a warehouse, still he is not liable to pay any duty, because he need not make any assessment. From warehouse when he releases, then only liability arises. But now under the new GST law, the moment he received the advance, liability arose and he has to pay there. Is it not harsh? So much of money on 50 crore, he is not eligible to take credit, and this fellow is not able to retain the amount. His working capital is affected, the money is kept with the government, sit pretty. If the deal is cancelled and he has to apply for refund, you know, refund procedures are very cumbersome in indirect taxes, whether it is GST or under the existing laws. Now you tell me, how harsh the government is on suppliers of goods, be it a manufacturer or trader, and it is having a telling effect on their working capital position both. I think you are able to get my point. So let the government think of it, because it is very harsh. To me it appears it is very harsh, and I don't know how it appears to you. Please, if you like my video, if you are new, you can subscribe. If you are already an existing one, you can press like button if you like it. Otherwise, you can also dislike this. If my proposition, if you are favoring government, I don't know, but I cannot favor government in this way. I can only favor the manufacturers, the suppliers, because ultimately the cost is passed on to the consumers. Because the cost is passed on to the consumers, they are not going to bear. Okay? So thank you very much. Please.